This is the look of a Russian revolutionary, Olga Korbut. All 80 pounds of her did things on the balance beam and in the air no one had ever seen. Opening ceremonies in Sydney are only 2 days away. During the first week of competition, the world will be focused on one of the game's most popular events, women's gymnastics. Popular largely because of what Olga Korbut did for the event 28 years ago. She demonstrated that a gymnast could defy gravity and flash a smile at the same time. What we're now learning is that behind that smile was one frightened little girl.
This is a most vital 1 minute, 20 seconds for Olga Korbut. The agility of this girl is quite remarkable. Because of her size, I suppose this is an advantage.
It's one of the greatest things to hit gymnastics in this modern era.
In 1972, the world discovered Olga Korbut. Her dazzling twists and tumbles at the Munich Olympics catapulted her to fame literally overnight.
Oh, look at that magnificent move.
In three short exercises, she transformed gymnastics forever.
Oh, isn't that superb? Absolutely.
No one had witnessed anything quite so daring, and no one expected a 17-year-old girl from the Soviet Union to be quite so seductive.
Olga instinctively flirted with the audience. She didn't blow them kisses or anything so obvious as that. But it was the smile, it was the little wiggles of her wrists and hands, this sort of thing.
Olga Korbut, UdSSR.
But the story of how the girl from Belarusia became the darling of the West was never as straightforward as it seemed. Relations with both the Soviet authorities and her teammates were notoriously difficult.
A lot of people didn't like her. It's in my country. Because she's not like everybody. She's different. And she never did try be like everybody.
But it was her relationship with her coach, Ronald Kinnish, that was the most turbulent of all. Only now is the real story beginning to emerge.
You know, before this interview, I wanted to forget everything, to forget what happened, because this is the hardest part in my life. I never talk and told about him bad words. But I think it's time to talk about this. Okay, let's start from the floor. This is carpet where you're not allowed to step until you are a gymnast. This is the bar. This is my favorite bars. All my life, sport life, when I did this element, I always care. Always. Okay, vault. I didn't care about the vault, but I was good in the vault, by the way. Okay, meet this. I don't like to talk about the vault. Okay, deep. For me, this is the floor, because we don't supposed to think this is a beam. Otherwise, you will be out of the beam all the time.
It's not difficult at all. It's all equipment, part of my life.
I first met Olga when she was about 8. I went around assessing the second and third grades. I told the girls there would be a gymnastics club in our school.
Of course, I was the first to raise my hand. I practically jumped up. That was the beginning of my dream.
I practice not just on the gym, I practice in my home. We had a small flat, but big room, enough to do gymnastics for me. And I moved all equipment, all furniture to the wall, and I built a small gym in my room, and I did gymnastics.
Home for Olga was an apartment on the first floor of number 3 Lenin Square, Grodno. When she was born in 1955, the town just by the Polish border was still recovering from the trauma of wartime occupation. Her father was an engineer and her mother was a cook. They had 4 daughters. Olga was the youngest. It was the time of the Cold War, the year the Warsaw Pact was signed. Brits Burgess and McLean were exposed as spies, and Laika the dog was about to enter space. Heroes mattered, and sportsmen like cosmonauts were vital to the Soviet image.
Probably few things were as important as sports in the Soviet Union. They were, if you will, the proof positive that socialism was the superior system. After all, we had a tremendous structure, and it wasn't that expensive. And we had some really outstanding experts who knew how to produce these champions. And it was done in a way where people were selected from childhood.
And so in 1965, at the age of 10, Olga left her physical education classes and entered the Soviet sports machine. The Red Banner Sports School in Grodno was one of the 4,000 specialist sports schools in the Soviet Union. Each year, the school held trials to identify future champions.
Olga was small and thin. Very small. She was a bit shy, but rather daring with the exercises I gave her. Maybe it was this daring, the fact that despite being the smallest, she managed to cope with exercises that made me take her on.
One coach at the Red Banner, more than any other, had a reputation for being a gymnastic visionary, Rinal Kanish. Kanish was on a personal mission to revolutionize gymnastics. He had already produced one Olympic champion. Olga would be his next.
I tried to bring in this new style, a lively, sharp, non-stop style. The Soviet style was the dying swan style. Slow, languid, you finish one movement well before starting another. I introduced a lot of quick, sharp, precise moves, one after another. Before me, people walked along the beam like it was a tightrope. I had my girls running up and down it like it was a floor.
Coach Rinal Kanish was so obsessed with perfection, the rumor around town was that he kept a card index system with details of married couples who had the right genes to produce gymnastic offspring. Everyone wanted to work with Kanish, and in 1966, Olga Korbut got her chance. And so began one of the more fateful teacher-pupil relationships in sporting history. Between them, Kanish and Korbut pioneered a whole new style of gymnastics. Out went polite, balletic forms. In came bold and dazzling maneuvers.
Olga was completely different because she did skill that nobody did this. And I think her coach wasn't care a lot how she looks. He just, I want this skill. Olga, let's go do this skill. Because nobody did this. You can do it. And you will be different than everybody. He was crazy. He fanatic. So, and she did go with him.
She had two bad injuries. Concussion, and her arm came out of joint. So they put metal rod in it. Olga had to have weight on it to straighten it. She would sleep with pillow tied to it, and that is how she slept, and that is also how she was able to perform later.
On the surface, the brilliant Svengali and precocious pupil looked the perfect partnership. In reality, though, relations were far from easy.
He pushed me very hard, really very hard. He never say me thank you or very good or something else. I expect this, but I never get it, you know. This is, was very sad for me, and I started to think about it, why it happened.
When I first started working with her, I didn't like her. She was very lazy, very capricious. She did not like doing what she was told, only what she wanted to do.
As a person, he was just a very bad man, a loner, a despot, a weirdo. As a coach, he was a genius.
At the heart of Kanish's vision was the belief that gymnastics could become a sport with mass appeal. It wasn't just about skill. It was also about image. So he taught Olga to be natural. He taught her to smile.
He worked hard on her in front of the mirror. She was supposed to smile, but Yenda's repetition made her cry. Her trainer knew it had to be part of the process. This smile has to be trained. Olga was a well-coached gymnast. Everything the audience saw had been coached into her.
Do you realize you practice every day, 15, 20 hours, whatever, 10 years, same thing, no rest, no holidays, no vacation, no Sundays, every day, no eat, no smoke, no drink, no boyfriend, no nothing, just practicing in gymnastics.
Probably the hardest part of all was the constant pressure to stay thin, and Olga wasn't averse to the odd cigarette to stave off hunger. Like everyone else, she had her methods.
I was always writing down when I could eat, and at the end of each day, I would check how successful I'd been and give myself a mark. I even counted how many sips of water I took.
The real trick to staying thin was to delay puberty. Whether Olga was given drugs for this is still not clear.
I don't even know. I know that when your period comes and a woman's body is weakened, it's hard for a gymnast. I have not had that experience of drugs, so I'm not the right person to ask about this issue.
After 3 years in the gym, Kanish was finally ready to present his pupil to the public. In 1969, Olga performed in her first adult championship in Rostov. the crowds witnessed something never before seen in a major gymnastic competition, a spectacular back somersault on the beam and an even more daring back somersault on the bars. The audiences loved her. The officials did not. Far from embracing her, they accused her of performing crude circus tricks.
It wasn't difficult for me because I prepared this for years. This was difficult for government, for head coaches to see that. Because they don't want to change. If, for example, if you have a good team, you don't need somebody who will change this. They have enough salary, they have enough, they have very good team. Team always win. You know, they just don't want to change.
For a while, the international authorities thought about banning Olga's back somersaults, but in the end, they were accepted, along with the rest of her stunts. By 1972, when she won the Soviet Gymnastics Cup, Olga was ready to claim her place on the Olympic team. But getting selected was another matter. Now, it was not her gymnastics that was the problem, it was her attitude.
Olga? Well, she was interesting, of course, and didn't always want to fit in with the team. But she was one of six team members, and she had to conform to the team discipline.
Although completely dependent on Knish, Olga always maintained that their relationship went no further than turbulent squabbling. But now, Olga is saying more. A few days before the Olympics, she says, Knish forced her to have sex with him.
He prepared me for years, slowly.
What did he prepare you for?
For sex. If you had an interview 72 or 73 and you asked me this question, I never pronounce a sex because for my ear is just sex, you know, without love. This is what I had.
You could put it that way. To begin with, it was very painful. I did not want it. I wasn't ready. It was my first time. I didn't love him. You see, all this together amounts to rape. When you don't love, don't want it, when you're afraid, it was all there.
She is lying. There were such coaches, of course, who channeled all of their energies into doing it with their pupils, but they did not produce any stars. As soon as you start to have sex together, the sport goes down the drain. Why would I have sacrificed 7 years of my life to her, forever accommodating her, forever forcing myself to psych her up, to plead with her, just to ruin it all in one go before the Olympics? What would I have gained? It's the most stupid thing I've ever heard.
She told me about this. She told me. It's kind of a shock for me. It was shock. I don't agree. Some I don't want talked about. And I think it's wrong that she try show these bad things about him. If it is true, it's between her and between him.
He will never admit that it's true. This is how he wants to silence me. But he won't succeed. He knows very well it's true. I do not have any proof. Nobody saw us. But I'm not looking for proof. I don't care about proof. I simply want to show my life as it really was.
She is totally overstepping the mark. She says the first thing that comes into her head. She knows no limits. We coaches have a saying, every pupil ends up spitting on your soul. But no one in the world has done it quite the way she has done it to me.
Headed for Munich, Knish went too. But in those days, individual coaches were not always allowed official accreditation. So he went as a tourist and took his seat with the rest of the audience. What he and the crowd then witnessed were 4 days of gymnastics that would totally transform Olga's life.
It was an immensely traumatic Olympics in many ways. It was the most dramatic Olympics I think I have ever been to, and I've been to 8. There was the tragedy of the Israeli team, many of whom were killed.
8 Arab guerrillas held 9 Israelis hostage.
We had Rhodesia being kicked out of the Games. We had huge stories about people like Mark Spitz winning 7 gold medals. So it was a tremendously dramatic Games. And it came across in Britain as no other Games has done up to that time. This is because the previous Games, television was really in its infancy. So these were the Games where people were able to come home at 6 or 7 o'clock in the evening and sit down and watch, of course, gymnastics. And this is why Olga had such an impact.
First time I saw Olga was in training. We'd actually got a training session booked, and one of them was booked with the Russians. And the English team were pretty nervous about training with the Russians, I can tell you. I mean, I was knocked out with her when I saw her in the gym, absolutely. And she only looked about 13, 14 maybe. And none of us believed she was 17.
Korbut was a girl. And if you look at Korbut's face, it looks like a girl. But it's also, and this was the interesting thing, this is why she was so curious and interesting as a figure, was that look at the lines in that face, even of a girl of 17. That's from doing, you know, 400 back somersaults onto a beam every day. That sort of routine.
Olga's style didn't just conceal effort, it also concealed danger. A couple of inches out on this landing could end in a broken neck. Catching the bar after this loop was equally risky.
If you do it a little bit less, you're out of the bar and you will have a concussion. If you do it like this, same thing. This very dangerous element.
Ironically, because she had this image as a sweet little girl, they didn't notice that what she was doing was rather tough, very tough, and required the kind of discipline, muscle, courage that was necessary to any man in the most difficult sport that there was.
The battle for medals at Munich lasted several days. The first gold medal up for grabs was in the team event. There was no question the Soviets were going to win it. They were better than everyone else. The real contest came with the individual gold for best all-around gymnast. And only 2 contenders mattered. The reigning world champion, Ludmila Toryshcheva, and the young upstart, Olga Korbut.
They're both famous, but they're completely different. And they didn't like each other. You know, they didn't understand. They didn't agree for each other.
Toryshcheva was much more of the ideal Soviet citizen. Controlled, precise, more technically correct. Whereas Olga Korbut was someone that they regarded almost as a sort of eccentric. And although they used that eccentricity and liked to promote it, nevertheless, the person they really liked was Toryshcheva. I mean, Toryshcheva's control was immense. I mean, we had the example at the World Cup at Wembley when she came off the asymmetric bars, and as she dismounted off it, the bars collapsed.
And the apparatus has collapsed, but she finished her exercise. Now, I wonder how that's going to be like.
And she didn't really look behind to see what was happening, because as far as she was concerned, you know, that was irrelevant to the performance that she'd just done.
Now, I wonder whether the judges will mind.
The discipline of that athlete was unbelievable. Put him in the ring, and 9 times out of 10, Tereshkova knocks her out. But the competition was the human factor. Again, Tereshkova looked like a fully developed woman. Here you had this little girl with the braids and the underdog, and that's where the competition really was.
To everyone's surprise, it was Korbut, not Tereshkova, who looked set to be the all-around champion. When she approached the bars, she was poised to take gold. What happened next put her on the front page of newspapers around the world.
And this is the girl who so far has captured this audience and enchanted us all. This is the apparatus she totally excels at. Except for that disastrous start.
When she went up to the apparatus, I knew she'd hit the floor with her feet. A coach gets a feeling for a pupil when they train together a lot. You feel it coming. Now she will slip in, and she does just that.
And another disaster. And she's lost it. There, the gold medal, I'm certain, has gone. This girl who had everybody talking about her.
Unbelievable, absolutely unbelievable. Especially that the first thing that she messed up was such a simple, well, it was nothing. It was just the beginning part. It wasn't even a skill. And then after that, she just completely couldn't get it together.
And the one event which could have captured gold for her, she has had a disaster. That picture says it all.
She broke down and wept. That was not what you did, and that was so human, and I think that had a lot to do with her popularity, because I think deep down inside, it was reassuring to a great many people all over the world that Soviets were actually human beings. I mean, the propaganda had gone so far in that Cold War that there was a sense that they were all the same, that they were produced by the same machine, they were cloned, and that here was someone who showed and proved that, no, they were individuals.
By now, Korbut's tears were the story of the Olympics, her disaster on the bars only enhancing her popularity. The following day, she had to perform on the bars again. This time, she found herself at the center of an even more unlikely storm.
This is one of the most remarkable exercises I have ever seen. It will be interesting to see how the judges mark it, but my goodness, that was quite fantastic. This little tiny girl, 17 years of age, moved between those beams, those bars, absolutely superbly. And everyone in this 11,000 crowd is giving tremendous applause for this girl.
9.8
is what she scored. They don't like it. I was wondering how the judges would accept it. But although it is quite unique, perhaps it doesn't have the finesse of some of the other competitors. There's a lot of very, very good stuff in it, and the crowd is going absolutely mad. Hark at the roars, the whistles that are going on through this building as this mark of 9.8, which is equal highest, and has put her in equal first place, is being received by the crowd. They just don't like it, and this competition will not go on while this noise is in progress.
It was a very good performance, and it probably got what it deserved, but of course the public didn't think that it got what it deserved, and therefore that they were actually outraged that she should have been marked down, and so they were incensed by this attitude of the judges.
And this girl, who's already been the scene of one incident in these championships, is now again, this time, has the support of the crowd, and the crowd's noise is getting more and more noisy. They're stamping their feet, they're whistling, and they're not going to let this competition go on.
When they stopped the competition, I didn't know what was happening. I didn't understand why everybody was shouting, why I got such a low score. I'd done everything just fine. Look, I fell yesterday, but I didn't fall today. Can't you see I'm ready?
And this is the biggest storm of the Olympic Games.
and it's quite impossible for this competition to continue under these conditions.
In the end, the judges refused to change Olga's mark, and it was left to the East German, Angelika Hellmann, to resume the competition.
That is probably the lack of concentration. She deserves the applause. She stopped that crowd shouting, and she deserved applause. Look at the girl. She is absolutely in tears. She had to face the most terrible odds.
When it came to the medals, Olga had to settle for second place.
Olga Korbut then gets the silver medal. So the gold.
It wasn't just the audience who thought she had been cheated. Most gymnasts at the time suspected that the Eastern Bloc judges tended to fix the medals among them.
In other words, the judges knew in advance who would win. If you said to them now, admit it or die, they wouldn't admit it, because they think they did the right thing for the country.
There was a socialist camp. At that time, gymnastics was particularly strong in our countries. And although we were the strongest, the Czechs, East Germans and Hungarians also wanted medals because they also had fine gymnasts. So there was a sort of secret plan. It went, okay, let's give the USSR 5 medals, but one must also go here, and one there. It did happen. It wasn't public. We didn't sign any agreements, but that's how it was done.
Но вот как-то так было.
Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
When Olga finally got a gold medal for her performance on the beam, few doubted she deserved it.
And they just love her, and she loved that gold medal.
But it was the very last gymnastics event at Munich, the floor exercise, that would finally launch her into superstardom. Most people were expecting Toreščeva to take the gold. After an almost faultless routine, she seemed unbeatable. But then it was Olga's turn. It was this performance that would end up being one of the most memorable moments in Olympic history.
And so the final competitor in the final exercise of the 20th Olympiad women's gymnastics competition just happens to be Olga Korbut. Olga Korbut was lying second to Toreščeva before the exercise started. If she gets 9.9 for this exercise, she will win the four exercises. And she is so vivacious, has got so much confidence, that she might just do that. Going for this girl. Apart from being very, very clever, she has such tremendous personality.
You know, I had just played with them, and when I finished, I had no doubt that the world was mine. I did what I had striven for such a long time.
Oh, that was terrific! How can you take it away from this girl? Isn't she marvelous? Olga Korbut has caused so many sensations here this evening, it just isn't true. And she's done it! She's done it! 9.9, Olga Korbut wins the gold medal in the floor exercises.
After when you finished routine and all team trying to hug you and congratulate you, but this is all fake. It's like Toreščeva. If ever she hugged me, I didn't see that it was fake.
what a fantastic climax to the women's competition of the 20th Olympiad. This girl, who on Sunday, I said, would be the darling of this...
There are times when you play or you do something above your own ability. I mean, you're grade 9, but you do a 10. And I think that's what happened to her. It was a combination of factors where she had the crowd, she had this up, she had the rush, and she had the technique. And it all came together and it worked magic.
Olga Korbut coming up again to receive a tremendous ovation and her second gold medal.
She captured the imagination of the public, and people still remember her. And they remember her for, you know, what she contributed on that extraordinary week in Munich.
Olga became the first star of gymnastics. She was a worldwide star. Wherever you went, everybody knew her name.
One of the greatest drawing cards and personalities in sport today.
You can get it if you really want. You can get it if you really want. But you must try, try and try, try and try.
She wants to be famous. You can see this. She won't be famous. She wants everybody to like her.
Olga Korbut is with me here at the moment. She is so tiny, and I think that picture gives you an idea of how tiny she is. I feel I could put my hand around her waist and pop her in my pocket. And with her is Lupita Nyong'o.
Got your mind set on a dream.
Olga!
You can get it if you really want. You can get it if you really want. You can get it if you really want, but you must...
It was clear Olga's charm exceeded the promotional impact of any cosmonaut or ballerina, and her government wasn't slow to catch on.
She was being used for a very clear propaganda purpose and was extremely effective. Do you think that it wasn't the Politburo that decided that Olga would meet President Nixon? Do you think that didn't go up to the very, very, very top, to Mr. Brezhnev? That's how high it went. There is no way that Olga Korbut could meet President Nixon. No way in the world without a decision at the very, very top.
If you really want, you can get it if you really want, but you must try, try and try.
On the other side of the Houses of Parliament is an old church called Westminster Abbey. The most interesting place here is the Poet's Corner.
Back in Grodno, a year later, world-famous Olga Korbut was brought back down to earth.
Tell us, please, something about London. London is the capital of Great Britain. Westminster is the political center of country.
She may have been filmed in the classroom, but most of her time was spent with Knish in the gym, and it soon became apparent that fame had changed both of them.
It became impossible to train. There was all the trips abroad and hundreds of journalists. How could you train? Every evening some millionaire held a party for her, and it was always Olga, Olga, Olga.
Their relationship changed. Olga perhaps thought, this is just my view, that she could now stop and show what she had done. That was not enough for Knish, who already had a new goal in mind and wanted her to climb to new heights through more hard work, through daily painstaking grind. And Olga had grown up.
Как
Мы не ругались.
We didn't argue in a sense of shouting at each other.
Я думаю, что да, мы всегда ругались.
But deep down, I think we always carried on this internal argument. But before 72, I never said anything about it. After 72, I began to speak out. It must have been unacceptable to him, I suppose.
Неприемлемо, наверное.
Before each coaching session, I had to psych myself up through self-hypnosis. I kept repeating to myself that since I had taken her on, I should treat her very gently, the same way trainers treat monkeys in a circus.
I never see and hear respect Olga like person. For him, Olga was just gymnast, just person who doing his idea, you know. I never saw that he liked her. You know, he all the time talked with her, kind of rude, make her like pinch somewhat. Like I didn't like. For me, so many times I was like shocked.
He started to hit me when I began to develop. He was very jealous. He suspected that I had someone else. My breath started to fill out. My body transformed. My figure was changing. He could see I was no longer a little girl. He would hit me out of jealousy sometimes, simply because I no longer obeyed him and had my own opinion. One day, I will never forget.
In front of everybody in the gym, he beat me. He broke my hair.
It happened only once, but it was enough for her to hate me for life. How dare he? Presidents have shaken my hand. Millionaires have kissed it. And this so-and-so slaps me just like that. That's how it was.
Olga and Kanish finally parted company early in 1975. Olga went on to train with Kanish's wife, Tamara Alexeyeva.
I was happy that I escaped from him. I began to work again and had a normal relationship, the kind that should be between gymnast and a coach.
The following year was spent in Grodno, preparing for the next big event, the Montreal Olympics. Expectations were high, but it was soon clear that Olga, without Kanish, was not the same Olga. In the end, she only managed one team gold and one silver medal on the beam. For the audience, the novelty was wearing off. Besides, a new star was being born.
Nadia Komanich. Another faultless display from Komanich. Performance. 10, the score that we said made Olympic history only days ago, now becoming commonplace for Nadia Comaneci.
That last year I was exhausted. I didn't want to work. I was stressed. I kept leaving and coming back again. After Montreal, I simply left gymnastics forever.
Six months after Montreal, Olga Korbut retired, but she left her mark on the sport. Because of her, gymnastics vaulted out of the clutter of Olympic events and into prime time. But there was another effect. After Olga, the pressure for more elaborate and risky routines increased dramatically. And so did the pressure to be smaller, younger, and thinner.
She changed gymnastics and she changed gymnast. There are no grown-up gymnasts anymore. There are no mature young women who look like women doing gymnasts. doing gymnastics. The sport has changed. You cannot win if your body has reached maturity. And I think that is very sad.
We did have a sort of anorexia problem in gymnastics, and no doubt about that at all. People were stopped from, eating as they would like to eat, because the lighter you are, the better.
Despite rumors of infertility caused by the training regimen, all six members of the 1972 Soviet team went on to have children. Olga herself had a son, Richard, in 1979, a year after her marriage to a Belarusian pop star, Leonid Bortkevich. For the next 12 years, she lived in Minsk, where she worked, among other things, as a sports administrator. Then, in 1986, 200 miles down the road, disaster struck.
The Russians have revealed little during the day of the extent of the accident at a nuclear power station in the Ukraine, but it is clear that this is a major disaster.
After Chernobyl, Olga and her family decided to leave the Soviet Union forever, and in 1991, they moved to the United States.
Today, Olga lives in South Jersey and trains young Olympic hopefuls at the Flyers Gymnastics Academy in Hamilton. Olga may be a few years older, but she can still show them a thing or two.
Within a few months of settling into her new coaching job, Olga suddenly quit after some of her pupils complained about her tyrannical training methods, a telling twist after her experiences with her own coach. Earlier this year, Olga and Leonid divorced, and Olga has since remarried. She now lives in a suburb of Atlanta in a house dedicated to her Olympic glory.
Okay. This is Munich gold medal. This is Montreal gold medal. This is Munich silver medal. This is Montreal gold medal. This, I have all four gold medals and two silver. This is just two gold, two silver. Two gold medals on the museum in Moscow and in Grodno. When I got from Munich, they said to me, you have three gold, can you give us one? I say, okay. That's it. This is last time when I saw my gold medal.
It's hard to think of a sport with a shorter career span than gymnastics, and it's hard to think of a sport where the difference between the time spent training and the time spent performing is so great. Olga Korbut spent 7 years training for effectively 4 days in Munich. Yet it was those 4 days that transformed her from an ordinary gymnast into a superstar.
For me, the point of gymnastics was to surprise, amaze, and delight. I think that's what I did.